After 2 weeks of talks, the COP27 summit wraps up with a landmark deal to create a fund that will help vulnerable countries cope with the devastating impacts of climate change. Developing nations relentlessly pushed for the Loss and Damage Fund and finally succeeded in getting the support of wealthy polluters. But jubilation over the achievement was also countered by stern warnings.
I call on us all to rise to the expectations entrusted to us by the global community, and especially by those who are most vulnerable and yet have contributed the least to climate change. I now invite the COP to adopt the decision entitled Funding Arrangements for Responding to Loss and Damage Associated with the Adverse Effects of Climate Change, including focus on addressing loss and damage. I hear no objections. It's so decided.
Our planet is still in the emergency room. We need to drastically reduce emissions now, and this is an issue this COP did not address. A fund for loss and damage is essential, but it's not an answer if the climate crisis washes a small island state off the map or turns an entire African country to desert. The world still needs a giant leap on climate ambition.
A final COP27 statement covered a broad array of the world's efforts to grapple with a warming planet and held the line on the aspirational goal of limiting global warming to 1.5 degrees Celsius. It also included language on renewable energy for the first time. But it failed to go much further than a similar decision from last year's meeting in Glasgow on key issues around cutting planet heating pollution. A Philippine environmental group believes it could still take about 2 years before the climate-related loss and damage fund can be operationalized. But as early as now, it says the Philippine government should prepare laws to ensure the funds it will receive will not be abused.
The details on how such a facility should operate, when it should be finalized, and the processes that lead up to it, those details still need to be discussed in the next few months after COP27. And one of those details includes exactly determining what kinds of loss and damage should be considered under this kind of global funding.
There's also a need for the Philippines to enact laws in order for us to have safeguards whenever this funding would be received, because conditions and terms sometimes are being controlled by developed countries, by those who are influential, Annex I countries. So when we have these global goals, when we have this global funding and decisions and agreements, we need to couple it as well with national laws.
Aside from visiting Palawan, one of the initiatives of U.S. Vice President Harris is to start talks on a civil nuclear cooperation agreement with the Philippines. The White House says the agreement, once in force, will provide the legal basis for U.S. exports of nuclear equipment and material to the Philippines. It's also in line with the U.S. commitment to working with the Philippines to increase energy security and deploy advanced nuclear reactor technology as security conditions permit. President Marcos earlier said he's looking into reviving the shelled Bataan nuclear power plant built during his late father's administration. U.S. Vice President Kamala Harris visiting the Philippines for the first time in an effort to boost Washington's ties with one of its oldest allies in Asia. She met with President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. in Malacañang this afternoon, where the Philippine leader appeared to downplay her upcoming visit to Palawan. Harris, meanwhile, asserts Washington's unwavering commitment to its mutual defense treaty with Manila. Here's a portion of their exchange.
Madam Vice President, I'm delighted to be able to welcome you to the Philippines on your first visit to our country after a very, very brief conversation back in Bangkok.
Yes.
And we have been looking forward to this visit for a while, and we've been preparing for it. The Vice President has been working hard to make sure that the visit goes well and smoothly. So, but we are happy that you have arrived. We are It's unfortunate that this is such a quick visit.
Yes.
We would have hoped to have shown you more of the Philippines. Although, I suppose you actually are doing that because you're seeing some of the prettiest parts of the Philippines in Palawan.
Yes.
And I'm sure you're just going to the resorts and the beaches. So
that is not the life I've chosen these days.
So I'm happy that that has been is really well established for very many years. The relationship between our two countries is something that we both our countries have really come to depend upon.
Yes.
And with the upheavals that we are seeing, especially in the not only in the region, but especially in the region, these partnerships become even more important. The situation is rapidly changing. We must evolve to be properly responsive to that situation. And so that is why it is very important that we continue to progress, that we continue to strengthen, and we redefine those relationships. So your visit is a very strong symbol that these relationships remain strong, mm-hmm. and that these relationships remain important, as indeed they do. So that is the Filipino. I have said many times, I do not see a future for the Philippines that does not include the United States. And that really has come from the very long relationship that we have had with the U.S. and the continuing to and of course we went through different phases of relationship, but as since the war, it has just been strengthened in every way, in the economic sense, in the political sense, defense, security. I cannot think of an area where we have not cooperated, collaborated, and have had good results for both our countries.
Thank you, Mr. President. Well, and thank you for the warm welcome. It was good, as you said, to see you in Bangkok and to have a brief time to talk there. But we were very much looking forward to this trip. I bring you greetings from the second gentleman who told me about great time that he had when he was here for your inauguration. And so he laid the path for this trip in many ways. But thank you. Yes, thank you for the welcome. I have traveled here because of many of the points that you have made. The relationship between the Philippines and the United States is a long and enduring one. It is a relationship that is strong for so many reasons. It is the long-standing relationship in terms of the people-to-people ties. As you and I have discussed, I come from California. We have a thriving Filipino-American community there. And in fact, in the United States, by last count, there are at least 4 million Filipino-Americans. Yeah. And
we're good Catholics.
Catholics who celebrate Christmas. According to you, in the Philippines, 3 months of the year.
Well, it's been said of us
wonderful.
That we celebrate Christmas like we invented it. We certainly own it now. So we start in September.
Well, it is good to be here with you in this season. And as you said, the basis of our relationship is multifaceted. Our relationship is based on mutual commitment to the economic prosperity of the region and our respective nations. And during the conversation that we have today, we will talk more about what that means in terms of the opportunities that are presented through our mutual concern about the climate crisis and what we might do in terms of investments in renewable energy and thinking about clean power and the industries that will come about because of that commitment and what that will mean in terms of economic prosperity through the creation of jobs, the creation of industries, and the bilateral relationship we have to coordinate in that regard. Our relationship is based on mutual concerns about security for the region. We are both proud members of the Indo-Pacific, and in particular, as it relates to the Philippines, I will say that we must reiterate always that we stand with you in defense of international rules and norms as it relates to the South China Sea, an armed attack on the Philippines armed forces, public vessels, or aircraft in the South China Sea would invoke U.S. mutual defense commitments. And that is an unwavering commitment that we have to the Philippines. When we think about what is happening in this region, we know that there are so many opportunities for us to continue to strengthen our relationship. But the basis of our relationship is based on mutual commitments to international rules and norms and upholding those international rules and norms in all of the ways that we know allow for, again, prosperity and security for our respective nations and the region. So again, I will reiterate that the alliance between the United States and the Philippines is a strong one, an enduring one, and only under your leadership continues to be strengthened. And we look forward to working with you on many of these issues. And I, of course, bring you greetings from President Joe Biden.
Well, thank you,
thank you, Madam
Vice President. Please do send President Biden my warmest regards. And I thank you for the very strong commitment that you have just made for the U.S. to be defensive of the Philippines.
Before meeting with Marcos, Harris also met with Vice President Sara Duterte. Malacañang, though, has yet to release details of their talks. Harris arrived in the Philippines Sunday night after attending the APEC summit in Bangkok. Ahead of the U.S. Vice President's visit to Palawan, Philippine authorities report another encounter with a Chinese vessel. On Sunday, the Armed Forces Western Command found an unidentified object floating near Pag-asa Island in the West Philippine Sea. As they towed the object to the island, a Chinese Coast Guard vessel approached their location and blocked their path twice. The Chinese Coast Guard then allegedly retrieved that object forcefully by cutting the towing line attached to the Philippine vessel. The Foreign Affairs Department says a thorough review of the incident will be conducted. Pag-asa Island, located some 285 miles west of mainland Palawan, is home to Philippine troops and civilians.